Welcome to the Audio Renaissance presentation of How to Work a Room, written by Susan Roane. Adapted for audio by Brenda Scott Royce. Produced by Tony Hutz. And now, here is Susan Roane.
Hi. It's been over a dozen years since I first wrote How to Work a Room, and the world has changed immensely. Over a million people around the world bought How to Work a Room because some things just don't change. One of the constant tenets is that we still get invited to events, parties, meetings, and conferences. And we want to be comfortable, confident, competent, and successful. The need to meet, mingle, make contacts, and conversation is even more important in the 21st century's internetworking world. Dr. Nathan Kaifetz's prediction came true. As Harvard professor emeritus of sociology in the mid-80s, he said that, in the year 2000, we will all be technically adept, but who will succeed will be the people who can talk to other people. Unquote. With social skills on the decline, those who have them will shine in any room. Talk, that is conversation, is how we relate, explain, persuade, sell, converse, amuse, learn, motivate, and connect. No matter what walk of life we pursue, we need to be able to break the ice, approach strangers, and start, build, and maintain conversations. We cannot build strategic partnerships, business, or social relationships unless we communicate. We cannot approach team building unless there is an exchange of words among members of the team. We cannot enjoy the benefits of brainstorming unless we are conversing. We cannot build a base of customers unless we are communicating. We cannot sell our services or products unless we can discuss them. A room full of people, especially of strangers, is still a daunting experience, even more so today. Why? Because we spend an inordinate amount of time communicating online. We've let our fingers do the talking and have lost our skill, courage, and confidence to face the face-to-face. We're addicted to email, bulletin boards, chat rooms, and e-commerce, thereby decreasing our ability to chat in a real room at an event. In the 1980s, 80% of adults self-identified as shy. In 1995, that figure increased to 88%, in part due to technology. We can get money out of a hole in the wall, the ATM, and never have to exchange pleasantries with a teller. We can get our stamps via the internet, our groceries can be ordered from the web, and we can talk to people's voicemail without ever having a conversation. These changes impact and decrease our day-to-day social conversation skills. In my audiences, when I ask how many people feel comfortable in a room full of strangers, it is rare that even 5% of the audience raise their hands, even among salespeople. But if they're already sitting in a meeting, attending a convention or yearly conference, or are in the keynote presentation, they're already in a group and just need some strategies, tips, opening and exit lines, and mostly the permission to talk to those yet unknown colleagues, cronies, contacts, clients, customers, and potential friends. This revised and expanded edition of How to Work a Room provides that permission, along with many more new, improved, tried-and-true strategies, examples, and ideas to work any room that I have garnered from over a dozen years with hundreds of audiences and over a million readers and listeners. I'm often asked how to converse with someone who is disinterested, bored, or aloof. One of the realities of life is that we will not click with everyone we meet. Their timing, interests, agendas, and values may be very different from our own. But the rooms will be full of other nice, interesting, friendly people who will be open to meeting, conversing, and doing business with us. If you are in situations where being able to work and be comfortable in any room is important professionally or personally, this program will give you the confidence and tools to walk into any room and shine. Has this ever happened to you? You pick up your mail, and there's a large square envelope. You can tell it's an invitation to something, and you're right. One of your clients is the honorary chairperson for a local charity, and they're throwing a huge fundraiser in 2 weeks. Not only should you go, but many potential clients will be there, and it is a chance to meet people and promote your business. Sounds like fun. But before you even have a chance to think about it, a little voice in the back of your head pipes up. Wait a minute. You'll walk into that enormous ballroom and see thousands of strangers. They'll all know one another, and no one will know you. Who will you talk to? What will you say? Your teeth start to grind, and you gingerly place the invitation in your wait-and-see file, or the circular one. You are not alone. This scenario happens daily in offices and homes across the country. It doesn't matter whether the invitation is for a social event, a business gathering, or a combination of the two. It is uncomfortable for most of us to walk into a room full of people we don't know, especially when we want to make a good impression. It's also one of the best business and social opportunities we'll ever run across. The benefits of being able to work a room with ease and grace are enormous. First, you feel better about yourself. You approach business or social gatherings with enthusiasm and confidence, knowing that this is an arena where you feel comfortable and productive. Next, you make invaluable business contacts as well as starting friendships that may last your whole life. If you hadn't been able to walk up to people, smile, put out your hand, and say hi, those opportunities might have been lost. You also make other people feel more comfortable, which makes them want to know and possibly do business with you. This program is designed to help you manage these events successfully, mingle with ease, and come away feeling that you have accomplished your own goals, made other people feel good in the process, and have had a good time. In the next 3 hours, we will focus on identifying the roadblocks that inhibit us from circulating with ease and comfort, and then eliminating them, providing a remedy to neutralize each roadblock, strengthening confidence and projecting your warmth, interest, and sincerity that invite people to open up, giving you practical tips and strategies for starting conversations, establishing communication, and building rapport with strangers. In the 21st century, those who have the personal touch will profit professionally. Working a room can be your number one marketing strategy. Visibility marketing is some of the best advertising you can get, and it's free. All of us work rooms. If you've ever been to a wedding, a reunion, or a meeting, you've worked a room. Or else you've come to a deep appreciation of how much easier and more pleasant life would be if you developed this skill. People in my audiences and at book signings tell me the most upsetting thing about these events is that everyone else seems to be completely comfortable. Trust me, they may only appear to be having a grand time. Most people don't like entering a room full of strangers for any reason. According to a study on social anxiety reported in the New York Times, the number one social fear is a party with strangers. It might even be said that if you didn't have some anxiety, you would not be normal. Most of us want to feel comfortable with other people, even strangers, and will do whatever it takes to minimize the anxiety and move through a crowded room with ease and grace. We want to be comfortable and to make other people feel comfortable with us. We want to manage the mingling so that we have fun, feel good about ourselves, score some professional points, and feel that even putting in an appearance is a good use of our time, especially since time is a commodity that is constant. Working a room is an old political phrase that conjures up images of overweight men in smoky back rooms, pressing flesh and cutting deals. That's not what we mean today. Today's definition of working a room is the ability to circulate comfortably and graciously through a gathering of people, meeting, greeting, and talking with as many of them as you wish, creating communication that is warm and sincere, establishing an honest rapport on which you can build a professional or personal relationship, and knowing how to start, how to continue, and how to end lively and interesting conversations. There is nothing manipulative about working a room. However, if you really don't care for and about people, then no technique in the world will help. People sense the truth. They usually know when they're being manipulated because you have an agenda or want to make a sale. They also know when you're making a sincere effort to extend yourself to them, and they appreciate it. My guideline is this: go to have fun and enjoy the people. The professional benefits will follow, but go! Working a room is a risk, no doubt about it. Our egos are on the line, and that can be intimidating. It can also be tremendously rewarding on both a personal and a professional level. Practice really does make perfect. You may find that you already practice some of the techniques I talk about. Good! Let this program serve as a reminder and sharpen your skills as you go along. The more you practice, the better you'll be. And above all, enjoy. If working a room is so much fun and so profitable, why do our hearts thump, our palms sweat, and our eyes glaze over when we think about it? One reason is that many years ago we were taught not to talk to strangers. Mom gave us these dire warnings with the best of intentions for our own good, and everyone agreed that we should heed them. The trouble is, they worked a lot better when we were 6 years old than they do now that we are 26, 46, or 66. Now that we're no longer walking home alone from first grade, these dire warnings have changed from safety barriers into roadblocks that prevent us from mingling comfortably and effectively with other people. Knowing where they come from is the first step to letting them go. And where they come from is our past. But don't just blame your mom. We heard these warnings so often and perhaps repeated them to our own kids so often that they became a way of life. But even more to the point, don't keep blaming your mom if these roadblocks are still standing in your way. It's your problem now, Bubala. There are 5 major roadblocks to working a room successfully. Those dire warnings can stop us at any time unless we apply the appropriate remedy. The good news is that for every roadblock, there is a remedy. Let's review the 5 roadblocks and discuss the remedy for each one. Roadblock number 1. Don't talk to strangers. This first roadblock is as American as apple pie. It is often accompanied by a shaking of the index finger. It made sense when our mothers told it to us, and it makes sense when we tell it to our children. But it doesn't make sense when we're selling a product at a trade show, beginning our first day on a new job, attending a formal ball, or mingling at a professional association meeting where contacts and connections are standing 6 deep around the room. Yet we often find ourselves standing in the door, paralyzed, with that imaginary finger shaking in our faces and the message, "Don't talk to strangers," flashing across our subconscious. So we don't. Instead, we choose a nice quiet spot at the hors d'oeuvres table and start nibbling, get very busy with a cup of coffee or drink, smile nervously around the room at no one in particular, and have an awful time. Or we hang out in the periphery of the room around the walls, hence the term wallflower. The problem is that by doing so, we also miss tremendous business, career, and social opportunities. Who knows what wonderful person or valuable contact was standing around that room, feeling just as uncomfortable as we were. Life is too short and time too precious to spend an hour or two squandering opportunities and having a bad time in the process. If roadblock number 1 is don't talk to strangers, remedy number 1 is redefine the term stranger. Mom says not to talk to strangers? Okay. Let's redefine the term. Obviously, we have to exercise some caution in today's society. Not every street corner in town is a suitable place to mix and mingle. And there will always be some people who, for some inexplicable reason, make you feel very uneasy. Go with your gut reaction. But if you're attending a meeting of professional colleagues, you're not really with strangers. If you go to a PTA meeting, you may not know anyone in the room. But you all have a common interest in quality education for your children. When you go to a new health club, a new church, a new synagogue, or a new political organization, you have a common interest with these people. Think about what you have in common with people at an event before you get there. These common interests can be the basis for conversation. Understanding what we have in common with others takes the edge off our reluctance to approach them as strangers. Use common sense when approaching people you don't know, but loosen up the definition of stranger so that mother's dire warning doesn't keep you from establishing contacts and communication. Roadblock number 2. Wait to be properly introduced, also known as the Scarlett O'Hara syndrome. Imagine Scarlett standing on the steps of Tara in all its antebellum glory, batting her eyelashes as she draws. My, but we haven't been properly introduced. Her beauty and charm notwithstanding, Scarlett wouldn't have gotten very far at a professional association meeting. In Scarlett's day and social sphere, everyone was aware of proper introductions, and there were people, usually older women, who did little else. They would make sure you met that gallant, dark-haired man or that stunning belle or the local banker who might be interested in your crop expansion. But tomorrow did indeed become another day, and you can't count on personal or professional matchmakers to be sure you're introduced around. Most of us were taught that it wasn't nice to talk to someone unless we'd been introduced by a mutual acquaintance. It is certainly easier to begin a conversation when you've been formally introduced, but at most events, we can't count on being introduced to anyone, let alone the people we most want to meet. We may be on our own when it comes to circulating, and we may have to walk up to people and introduce ourselves. If roadblock number two is wait to be properly introduced, remedy number two is practice a self-introduction. Scarlett O'Hara may have needed a proper introduction, but we live in a different world. We may never meet another living soul if we wait for a fairy godperson to magically appear and introduce us around. We'll just stand in the corner watching the real room workers who seem to be totally comfortable moving around the room, conversing and circulating through the crowd. Every so often, you actually get lucky and attend an event that has a greeting committee. The problem is, not everyone on the greeting committee knows who you are, who you want to meet, or how to introduce you properly. So they may not be able to give you much of an introduction, and they may not introduce you to the people you want to meet. Don't let yourself be limited by their lack of skills, their lack of information, their lack of contacts, or all three. The truth is, we are on our own. Therefore, we need to have a planned and practiced self-introduction that is clear, interesting, and well-delivered. What you say about yourself will depend on the nature of the event. For example, at a Chamber of Commerce reception, you could say your name and what you do. But at a purely social function, your occupation may not be as important as how you know the host or hostess. Your self-introduction should be tailored for the event. When I attended a wedding in Chicago, for instance, I didn't use my business introduction as best-selling author and professional keynote speaker, although I was prepared with business cards in my evening bag. Instead, I said warmly, "I'm the first girlfriend of the father of the groom." Trust me, conversation started. A good self-introduction includes your name and something about yourself that establishes what you have in common with the other people at the event. It shouldn't be long, only about 7 to 9 seconds, but your self-introduction should give the essential information and perhaps something interesting that may engage people in conversation. For example, a stockbroker might say, "Hello, I'm Jack Jones. I help people take stock of their lives." A newcomer to a professional association could introduce herself by saying, "Hello, I'm Shelley Berger. This is my first meeting and I'm feeling a little bit awkward." Once you've planned how to introduce yourself, practice it. You will feel much more at ease with it. Roadblock number three. Don't be pushy. Good things come to those who wait. Waiting for people to find you and introduce themselves is an exercise in futility. Chances are they won't, because it's just as difficult for them as it is for you. The waiting game is a colossal waste of time and murder on your self-esteem. Even the inventor who actually does build a better mousetrap has to get out there and let people know about it. If he doesn't, he'll sit at home for the rest of his life with no mice, but no fame or fortune either. He might as well have bought a cat. People who wait for others to come to them can often be found in the corner of the room, holding up the walls, envying those who glide around the reception meeting people. And let's talk about pushy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.